I couldn't. Somebody else could.
Rachel Giordano, Joel Pelkaner. Who were the other two?
Nancy.
Kevin Winder.
And Nancy Cook. Those are the four executive directors. Because we're an incorporated nonprofit organization.
Kevin, Nancy, Rachel, sorry, who were the other ones?
Joel Pelkaner.
And Kevin, was that the other name?
Kevin Winder, Nancy Cook, Joel Pelkaner, and Rachel Giordano.
Thank you.
So, Bill Ford, any other comments or questions before we start? Okay, if not, we'll turn it over to, I guess, Scott Sears first.
Is there, the young man who's doing the videotaping, he understands these things, right? In terms of his projector?
Josh.
It's just the computer. I have to press the shift key or something, right?
Yeah, I don't know what they're doing. But
won't give them any help. Yeah, well.
This tends to work.
I'm sure he's working.
Actually, this is reminiscent of the reason why I love Tammy going to this.
You are nearly as red faced as I was.
Have reasonable decorum at this meeting. No booing, no cheering, no clapping. This is a presentation from this organization to the village board. There will be a time during the public comment period that the public will make comments about that or other things, but this is their presentation to the village. There's no questions coming from the audience. The village board may want to ask questions as we go along. This is not a dialogue with the public, just to let you know.
So just to, along those lines, I'm going to kind of do this straddle thing where I have my back to Warden all the time, you know, and my, but...
I'm used to it.
As has been pointed out, this is primarily a presentation that TBNA is doing. It will be myself presenting, and I'll introduce myself in just a moment more fully, as well as Paula Hergen. And so we'll primarily be facing this way as we're talking. I guess is the point that I wanted to make. So we appreciate this opportunity, TBNA, to be able to make this presentation to the board as well as the public. My name is Scott Sears. I'm 355 Pennsylvania Avenue. I'm a member of TBNA, and I think in this case a validated presenter or a spokesperson.
Hi, thanks for standing up.
So, in my professional life, what I do is I work with communities, municipalities, organizations, all sorts of different groups to help them think about where they're at in point A and how they move to point B, often around planning, around strategic thinking, etc. So that is kind of the role that I am playing to some extent within this group. And that's why I'm here tonight in this role at this moment. There's a lot of detail and a lot of complexity in what we're going to be presenting tonight. So hold on to your chairs because there's a lot of getting ready. And as Marty pointed out, it's not going to really be until the public comment period, if I'm correct. It's not really going to be questions about it. So if you're thinking about something or something you really don't understand, please write it down and think about it. Okay? All right, so moving forward before the slide tracker turns off again. So Truman Square Neighbors Alliance, here's this purpose statement. As has been indicated already, we're incorporated with New York State as a not-for-profit. And the membership comes from throughout the community. And I would say village and town folks. As you can see in the purpose statement, I'm not going to read it, but really the goal of TBNA is to work together with citizens and the local government to really be looking towards most responsible land use planning and development possible. Why this analysis report? I actually have only a few copies. We can make more copies available as desired and as appropriate. But really what happened is TBNA came together initially out of interest in the Hamilton Square project. But in so looking at that, it became clear that there were a variety of inconsistencies, inadequacies within and across the zoning ordinance, subdivision law, and the comp plan. So it's like the focus shifted from Hamilton Square specific to the zoning subdivision and comp plan and how those are integrated, or what became apparent is not as well as they need to be in order to provide the kind of protections and future thinking that we think would be good for the village. So tonight's opportunities, what we're hoping to get out of tonight, in addition to being able to go through the report and have the board understand, well-informed, see all the intricacies that we're speaking about here, we've discovered and unearthed. I guess that's my first point, is that because our sense in having done this analysis is that the village is really at risk to a character-changing development. And we want to assist in actually being able to have an informed conversation about that in terms of what it is that the committee wants, it values, and how its laws are set up to make sure that happens. So I think I kind of covered those. And at this point, I'm going to turn it over to Paula and let her introduce herself. And thank you.
Thank you. I'm Paula Hergen and a 30-year resident of Ulysses and also married to Scott Sears, just for full disclosure.
I am a professional landscape architect, Professor Emerita from Cornell University of Landscape Architecture. And I started the Conservation Advisory Council here before SEACR was even implemented in the village of Trumansburg. I spearheaded for 20 years the Main Street project, almost 20 years, to make that happen here in Trumansburg. I sat on the town planning board, so I've had a lot of experience in our community, both at the town and at the village level. And I know how difficult and how contentious development can be. And let me tell you, when I came to town and I started the Conservation Advisory Council at the request of the mayor, the first project was the expansion of the golf course from 9 to 18 holes. And that didn't look so good for somebody who just newly arrived to town to be thinking about water, stormwater, all of those kind of things on a golf course that the community was very invested in. So I know how contentious change is, but that's not to say that we don't need to fully embrace the importance of that kind of change and be really responsible to the future of our community. Because all of us are here because we love and adore this community and this village. And for me as a landscape architect, I really love the land. I have a love for the land. So what's zoning? We're going to talk a little bit about zoning and talk about this ordinance. And just so you also know, everybody from the village board was given this document we prepared. It's 38 pages long. It's also given to the planning board and the zoning board, and they were given to it in advance. I'm not sure everybody got a chance to read it. It is really complicated. It's one of those things you kind of go blurry-eyed when you look at the zoning ordinance, and even when you probably look at our report, because it's a little confounding. But what's zoning? Zoning is what land is used for, and the zoning map and the zoning ordinance dictate what those land uses are, where the things can happen, the size of the lots, the dimensions, the basic measurable requirements and standards for development. But subdivision, on the other hand, is how land is used, and it is really addresses the division of larger lands into smaller lots, how they'll be laid out, the quality of the infrastructure, the parks and open spaces that will be in that tract, and how that land develops in a way that fits and connects to its context. And of course, zoning and subdivision occur in relationship to site plan review and SEACR, Village Environmental Quality Review Act, and SEACR, and all these together guide development. So what's our dilemma? Why is TVNA here? It wasn't hard for a lot of us, including people like myself with even professional experience and a lot of affection for this community. We've been around a long time to say, what is happening in the zoning ordinance that was completed after the 2008 comprehensive plan that's allowing development, or at least potential development, that seems so unlike the pattern, scale, and type of housing and land use that distinguishes Trumansburg's rural community character and which the comp plan prioritizes to preserve. This is basically why we all be doing it. What's going on? And I can tell you a lot of people have felt that. They've felt disturbed, distressed, wondering what's going on, why some of the proposals we're seeing before us. So let's take a little look at the zoning and the history. Before 2012, we had a zoning ordinance in place from 1971 to 2012. And this is something very interesting. The 1971 ordinance limited in the R1 district, that's the big residential district, that area to one and two family homes. Anything above a one or two family home required a special permit. Multiple dwellings were allowed, but the ordinance was designed specifically to address units that were less than three families, so one and two, less than three. There was also some dimensional requirements in that ordinance. I guess, I don't know if this that pointer doesn't seem to work. There were dimensional requirements there, 15,000 square feet for the first family, 7,500 for the second, 5,000 for the third. This is interesting. It's exactly the same dimensions we have today for 2012. However, there was a very interesting little piece there. Those dimensions were in the same structure, so you had to have the same structure would expand to accommodate those dimensions. And you'll see where that comes into play a little bit later. Okay, this works.
Towards your computer. I think, or towards your computer.
All right, so it's kind of interesting to see that we've had a dominant pattern in the village from 1971 to 2017 that is mostly one and two family homes. I mean, you see that in the village. That's mostly one and two family homes, and you can see the details here. We have basically 447 acres of active residential within the whole village, 90% of which is one and two family homes, and we have another 10% that are basically three family or more. So that's the story. That's what our village looks like. That's how it's evolved. That's how the zoning has supported that kind of development. Then we have what I call the zoning revisions era. We have this period from 2001 to 2012. And we had 2 6-month moratoriums in 2002. Basically, there were some serious issues. People had to come together and revise the, develop the VEQR, Village Environmental Quality Review Act, because the village was out of compliance, and also revised the zoning to incorporate subdivision. There had never been any subdivision regulations in the 1971. And then, during that period, we also started to begin this comprehensive plan process. Then from 2008 to 2012, the comp plan was adopted. We had two more moratoriums because we needed to amend the zoning. There were some big things happening in the village, like the acquisition of the manufactured home park, the Alba home parks, and so on. So we had the village changing. And then we had two more moratoriums to amend the zoning for adult entertainment and industrial development. And then finally, we have the zoning plan filed. The new plan was filed. It took, I think, forgive me if I'm wrong, 3 or 5 years to create the new plan. How many?
Three.
Okay. Important is that it happened, the zoning happened without revisions to the subdivision. Just a quick look at the difference between the two ordinances. 1971, R1 district is limited to one and two family homes. 2012, there's no limit on how many families and how homes can range from one family to 100. Special permit was required for more than two families. There's no special permit required for any housing type. Multiple dwellings, the ordinance was designed for less than three families. The ordinance today does not specify any range of residential. It has, basically, there's an undefined range of residential building types. We have the same square footage, both areas. However, there it said it could only be in one structure. In the current ordinance, it's not necessarily required to have a single structure. So then we have this big stop, the stopwatch. 2012 to 2017, county imposed development moratorium. Hasn't been a lot happening in the village because we needed a water source and also needed to upgrade the sewage treatment plant. So that was a big moment that basically we developed a new zoning ordinance, had a moratorium, and basically that ordinance remained dormant for 5 years, unable to be used for major subdivision and development. In effect, untested, not able to be used. And now we have this threshold moment, celebration, cause for celebration. We have our infrastructure upgrades complete, sewage treatment plant, second source, the county moratorium lifts, the village is newly primed and attractive to major development. It's a fertile ground for development. It's the first time the 2012 zoning ordinance can be used for major subdivision. There's more money to support village and developers needed. Basically, we have the need, because we're a fertile ground for development, to have more staff to support that. We have the Village Planning Board and the Zoning Board debuting knowledge, procedures, and roles related to major land development they have never practiced. We have citizens and neighbors that are awakened from an era of slow, small, piecemeal growth to basically, whoa, it's a fertile ground. People are knocking on the doors. And we have an unpreparedness due to outdated laws. We revised the zoning ordinance. We did not revise the subdivision that goes back to 2002. We have uncompleted studies from the comp plan that were never put
never done, so they could not be incorporated into the zone. We don't have some relevant laws or guidelines that relate to things like sustainable green infrastructure that is a very important thing in today's world. So let's look a little bit at the 2012 zoning and dig a little bit deeper. I encourage people to go back and read the purpose statement of the zoning because it is fairly, you know, uplifting and positive. It talks about avoiding undue concentration of population, safeguarding homes by preserving the attractive environment of residential areas, implementing the Village of Trumansburg's comprehensive plan. It has noble goals. And it, above all, it really talks about the zoning trying to develop and reinforce guidelines and rules that are going to, in the end, produce the kind of environment that people love and adore and characterize as Trumansburg. I won't go into all that detail. People don't read this stuff. Things that were included in the zoning updates for 2012, more flexibility and permissiveness, I already mentioned that, in the R1 district for higher densities, the affordable housing code requiring a percentage on larger development, which I think we would all agree is a good thing, and we know that Trumansburg has been at the foreground of that. Lot area and frontage reductions for affordable housing were included. Plan development was added to the code, but there was nothing added to the zoning map to show where that would happen. A large range of building types were suddenly allowed. Detached or attached multi-unit buildings are allowed. And then we have changes to the code without definitions to support, or vice versa. So the stress of the ordinance, the affordable housing is definitely a strength of Section 308. The planned development area is a strength. We have an added variety in housing densities and options with both the planned development area and the affordable section. We have zoning that relates to the gateway and the downtown districts. We have an R2 district related to manufactured housing. People can scrutinize and look at the zoning rules, but I'll show you a map in a minute. But we also have some weaknesses and threats that we consider are weaknesses and threats. A generic code across the whole district, you're going to see that in a minute, which is almost 1 square mile. But the single R1 district neither reflects the village's historic morphology, how it developed over time, or planning for growth with concern for value and optimal use of undeveloped land. They're imprecise and contradictory definitions and codes. There's incomplete or missing codes. Large lot size reductions, which I'll get to a little bit later, without regard for rising impact on open space, socioeconomic issues, and stormwater. There's a lack of integration with subdivision. There are outdated companion laws. I've already talked a little about that. And there's a failure to reflect the comp plan. An important issue as well is that the comp plan, which was finished in 2008, had very specific actions that would enable effective land development. Those included, you'll see a little bit more about that later, but one of those was, what are the preferred uses of undeveloped land? Have a plan in mind that you can use. Update the subdivision regs. That was an immediate action. Create a village network plan. You can see code around the state where villages actually have the road plans for what they would like to see in the future. So when a developer comes, they can refer to the road network plan. It's already been thought out. You also have an open space and recreation plan, so you can think about connectivity, distribution of open space, where parks and open spaces should occur in the community. Are you going like that because I should go faster? You're just going, yeah, you're great. Anyway, what I'm here to talk a little bit about and focus on, and it is deep and wide, and it takes a lot of kind of getting your head around it, but these things. Areas of primary concern, the zoning map, the dimensional requirements, definitions and interpretation, reduced lots, areas for affordability, code specifics, and what to do about it. I'm just going to start with the map, and it's really easy to see the map that it has a lot of one color.
That is one district called the R1 district. There's two residential districts in the village. This is R1, and R2 is the green at the upper corner, which is where the manufactured housing is, the auto trailer park. But you can see that there's an undifferentiated R1 area. That means what happens that close, this is the village center. What happens right there could happen there, 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 there. Could happen as close to the center or as far from the center. The same thing could happen. And that's an important thing, that there's this undifferentiated, large, one square mile with one set of rules. Which, again, we all know, and we've heard it from many people in this community. Wow, when you look at the map, there's a lot of texture right around the center. That's the oldest part of the village. Smaller lots around the edge. It used to be surrounded by bigger farms and open space. Now those have been infilled in places, and then we have large, if we get further away, we see larger lots. That is a big concern, this one district that's undifferentiated. I'm going to show you a little bit later. I'll show you the implications of that, because when you're looking at these issues that we're talking about right now, you're going to see that all of these things are issues that affect the entire Arlen district, no matter where you live. Okay, starting with definitions. We have a code that says, this is the definition of a dwelling. A building or portion of a building used or designed as a residence or occupancy by one family. A single-family dwelling is a detached building containing one dwelling, two-family, a building containing two dwellings located on a single lot. Important to remember that. One single lot you can have a building on. A multiple-family building is a building containing three or more dwellings located on a single lot. So if we ask the question, what is the definition of a dwelling, we can refer to this definition. So we think. However, we are seeing that the answer is it might be detached or attached, a duplex, semi-attached, semi-detached, an apartment, a townhome, a townhouse, a condo unit. We don't know exactly. There's a lot of definitions of dwellings, right? This is the one we think would be the one that we would abide by. When we look at that in combination with the dimensional requirements chart, this is the chart. It's referred to a lot by the zoning enforcement officer when somebody comes in. You basically see what area is required. We have this interesting little term here. For the first dwelling, you need 15,000 feet. For the second, you need another 7,500. For the third, you need 5,000. But it's whether it's attached or detached. Attached or detached. Okay, we get to that a little bit later. For the first dwelling, it says, for the second dwelling, for any additional dwellings on the property. So that also makes it sound like, wow, you could have multiple dwellings on the property, right? So it suggests, there's a suggestion in here that it's allowable to have either one building or multiple buildings on a property. This is very interesting. And I just want to turn this, this comes up a lot in this ordinance, is that there are not definitions provided for these key and important terms. So when you look at a code like that, you cannot look in the definitions and see how the village is defining that. It appears in the code, but it doesn't appear in the definition. These are all definitions. This is really interesting, this detached or attached. If you want to do a little research on that, there are a lot of ways that detached and attached are represented in different codes. A detached building can mean a standalone single-family dwelling sharing no common walls with another unit. We probably, a lot of us, live in detached single-family homes. They sit all by themselves. But a detached building can also mean a side-by-side residence with a separating property line between buildings, though they share, with a share party walls, but they have a separating property line. So that would be like a condominium. Or, yeah? Okay. A two-family dwelling. Building containing two dwelling units for two families with conditions such as if not owner-occupied, one unit must be no greater than 50%. These are definitions taken from other codes. But yeah, basically, a two-family dwelling could have rules that basically the second dwelling cannot be more than 50% of the first. And the families that occupy it have to be related. There's a lot more, or there are conditions for that. Then we have a single-family attached. It's often called a duplex and accommodates two families. A one-family semi-attached, it's like a duplex, contains not more than two one-family dwellings with access to the ground floor with a separating property line. So you can just see the dilemma here. We have definitions are very important to understand. If you look at the city of Ithaca zoning code, they have specific definitions. They have diagrams that go with those definitions that allow you to ascertain the distinction between these building types. Very important. So you can see how they are interpreting the one-family detached. Probably looks like a lot of lots you guys live on. One-family semi-detached. One house, property line goes down the middle, so the house is basically straddling two properties. One-family attached, basically a single building for three or more one-family dwellings, each with access to the ground floor. And a lot of codes have a limit, as the city of Ithaca does, that you can only have six attached. That will be your maximum. So definitions really matter. They are really important. Ithaca code, I just mentioned, has for dwelling. They don't just have one definition of dwelling. They have a definition for multiple dwelling residents. They have one family, detached, semi-detached, blah, blah, blah. They have two families. They have a dwelling unit distinguished from a dwelling. Casanova, which I'll get to a little bit later, has definitions and diagrams for those different unit types. Definitions are really important. Principal buildings. What our code says. Buildings, structures, and uses that define the chief physical structures and uses of land on a site. There may be more than one principal building structure or use on a property. A common example is an apartment complex that includes more than one building with apartments. There is no definition in the Chippensburg code for an apartment building. But the big thing I want to point to here is if I ask the question to Matt, how many principal buildings and how many accessory buildings can I put on a lot? The answer would be as many as you can fit there if you have the area that's needed according to the area requirements chart. So if you have a big enough site, you can put not one house on it. You can put multiple homes on it. Right, Matt? Yeah.
This is a presentation to the board.
No, I just wanted him to confirm because it is.
But I've just remembered, it's a presentation to the board. Sorry. Not the audience.
No, Matt's the zoning enforcement office. It's the only
village board, not other people in the audience. Right. Okay, just remind me.
Okay. But anyway, the key here is that there may be more than one principal structure or use on a property. That is the key thing, and that is a very big distinction, that you can have more than one building, because there's also another definition of accessory buildings. And accessory buildings are accessory to, they're smaller than the principal structure, the, or uses on a site, and are customarily found on the same site. So if I asked how many accessory buildings of what size are allowed per lot, it would also depend on the size and number of principal buildings that I already have. So I could in fact have many accessory buildings. And if I had a very large building that had 20 units in it, I could have an accessory building that was larger than it to accommodate maybe a parking garage or something like that. Now, if you guys have any questions, because I am speaking to the board, if you have any questions, ask them. You don't understand. Okay. Since Hamilton Square is the largest development project that's come before the village in many decades, if not in its history, these are among the building types that have been proposed in the different proposals that we've seen. There's a whole range of building types, single family, two family duplex, and this means market rate or affordable, by the way. Two family duplex affordable, townhouse type, townhouse group, multifamily apartments, multifamily one unit. This is two buildings, one unit. We've seen all of those. We've also seen some scale issues that we have in the current proposal for Hamilton Square. One building that is 360 feet long by 80 feet wide in the R1 district, which means, and I just compared it to SureSave, if you wanted to see a comparable from the liquor store to the end of SureSave, that size building can go in the R1 district anywhere. So like I said to you earlier, you can have one close to the village if you have enough land area, or as far away as you can have it. So that's what we're seeing, the code allows, and that's what we're seeing in recent proposals. We also have this question, the definition of a lot. Lot is a parcel of land occupied or capable of being occupied by one building, an accessory building, or uses customarily incident to it, including such open spaces as are required. Interesting that a lot kind of makes it sound like you can have one building, an accessory building, doesn't it? This is a very interesting definition. It's the same definition from 1971 and the same definition in the 2012 ordinance. This is one thing that did not change. We have the same definition of a lot from 71 to the current. But if I ask the question, how many buildings per lot? Because the definition of principal buildings says you can have more than one principal building, there can be more than one building per lot. So you may have many principal and accessory buildings if you have enough area. So you're beginning to see how these definitions relate to one another and impact one another, and how sometimes the logic is befuddling. It's very hard to get clarity. This is what we're seeing on the Hamilton Square proposal in terms of lots. So these are just kind of excerpted from the most recent plan. So you have basically two buildings with five units, another two buildings. We have another four buildings here. Oh, actually, this is the earlier one, obviously. Now we have a different group. But those are all in a single lot. And this was the proposal from August, which was one single lot showing 17 buildings on that lot. Two frontages on the public road. The rest of the lot had 17 buildings. Most of those buildings had three or four units in them. And also, in this case, there was a community center. So you can put 17 buildings on a single lot, according to the zoning ordinance. And just because one of our members of TDNA has 10 acres on South Street down the road, we just did a little application to their property of the same kind of concept. They could actually put on their 10 acres all these buildings without subdivision. If they decided, this is the Garner's property, if the Garner's decided, basically, that they wanted to develop an apartment complex on their property, they own this property, this is their house, right here, and they own all this property behind them. They could put a driveway past their house. Well, actually, it could be a road, we call it a road. They could have a road into their apartment complex, and a loop that comes out, fitting the qualifications that any road has to have two entrances and exits on public streets. They could do this without subdivision of the property because of the zoning right now, which says that you can put as many buildings as you want as you can fit on that lot. And if you have an affordability component, you can make more buildings on that single lot. There wouldn't be any variances of plot required. There would, however, be site plan review. So basically, the planning board would get to determine how beautiful it's going to look and trees and so on and so forth, or part of it. This has some advantages because it has a link to the Twinsburg schools. But anyway, it's just to make the point that this is what we've got in the current zoning ordinance. So,
private road. This has been in a discussion lately. Private roads, this is what the code says. Any private road serving more than one lot or more than two buildings shall be constructed to meet village specifications for right-of-way roads and cross-sections as approved by the local superintendent of public works. So here I'm really concerned about what's the lot frontage that I would need to put in a road. What kind of frontage do I need on the access road? That's one of my concerns. So I'm asking the question, well, what lot frontage and access road frontage is required to build a private road? And the answer would be that there is no minimum lot frontage, and you can build a private road if it serves only one lot or two buildings without conformance to village standards. This was noted at a recent planning board meeting by the code enforcement officer that yes, you can build a private road, private drive. You can even just throw gravel down for that drive.
I've been taken out of context.
Well, it was
not a board member. I was referring to building code, not to.
Okay, well, in building code.
Okay, right. That's a big difference.
Okay, but that
you're
does,
not
okay.
reviewing.
What's up?
You're not reviewing.
Okay, there's
you and Jacinta.
Okay, that's
not. This is not time for the public to question comments or whatever. Please.
But it leaves the whether it's building code or zoning code, it does appear that you. What we are seeing right now, and this was in the context of the meeting that we saw the other night, the most recent proposal from the developers, that basically a private drive can have its own, in this case, they have basically got a private drive coming from South Street into a development, and it is its own lot. It's a lot unto itself. Because that drive is basically supporting one property, which would be the nursery school, it does not have to conform to village specifications for a road. It is a private road. And so many of the discussions that people have had is why doesn't that road have to conform to village specifications? Because in this case, I know this could be clarified with the developers, but what I understand from looking at their plans is that there is a separate lot for the road, and the access to the nursery school is off of that road or drive. Therefore, it is accessing only one property, and therefore it is a private road, and therefore it does not require conformance to the village's road specification. It also happens to be joining two public roads, but that's neither here nor there. The point is that these kind of ambiguities, like the difference between a private and a public, and how these are being compounded, is very confusing to many of us. So basically, we've also been asking public road frontage. Okay, so that was the private road. Now let's go to the public road. What does the code say about public road frontage? How much frontage do you need on an existing road to put a new road in from it? Okay? The code doesn't say anything. It says absolutely nothing. So if we ask, what's the lot frontage needed to build a new public road serving a major subdivision into an otherwise landlocked parcel? Well, it might be up to the ZBA or the planning board, but it's unclear, and don't ask the village planner because he says there's nothing in the code. So there isn't anything in the code. This is what the code says, nothing. Here's what the subdivision regulations say. So here's where we have to refer to the subdivision. They say all required road improvements shall be designed, constructed, and installed to conform to village design specifications. And they outline those specifications. Further clarification may be obtained from the village engineer. So if we ask that question again, the village street specs say a 50-foot right-of-way is required for public roads, but there's no frontage minimum. There's no frontage minimum on the street. It appears to be up to the village engineer and ultimately the planning board that reviews and approves subdivision. But as we've seen, the village ZBA has given variances on right-of-way minimums. And and seen, they've seen that as their jurisdiction. That's it. For those people who don't understand that, we had in the case of the project that's before us in the community, or the board understands this, but we had a variance granted by the ZBA a year in advance of the subdivision application coming before the community, before the planning board. So we had a variance granted for a road right of way. Anyway, what else does the subdivision say about road frontage? It says there should be a sufficient width, suitability, constructed to conform to the master plan, accommodate traffic, have access for fire fighting, blah, blah, blah. So, what is the master plan for new roads, and who decides what a convenient road system is that creates no undue hardship to adjoining properties? This is a big question. What is the master plan? So, the answer to that question is there isn't a master plan to follow. So that means a developer can self-direct in terms of road layout, because the village has not developed a master plan for road layout. And as I mentioned earlier, communities have road plans. They're thinking ahead in terms of where are the optimal places to put those roads. So it appears that the village engineer and the planning board would make the final determination on layout for new roads and to anticipate future road networks as related to long-term land use goals. Anyway, what we're seeing in the South Street proposal is we have three frontage areas, 100 foot, 47 foot 6, 48 feet, and some, a little bit more. But we have three different frontage areas, and nobody can say which one is really the conforming frontage. I think many of us assume that you would need 100 foot of frontage, just like any residential property would need 100 foot of frontage to develop into it. But we're seeing public road being proposed through two very narrow areas adjacent to existing property. So the lack of clarity about what is the minimum road widths, I think is something that needs to be ascertained and also developed perhaps in the future land use ordinance, especially in areas where you have more dense development already in place and where a new road is going to have an immediate impact on adjacent property. So then we get around to affordable housing, lot size reductions. And we have the affordable code is an important addition to the ordinance. But it comes with these reduced dimensional requirements. Not that those are bad at some scales, but as the scales get bigger, there's bigger impacts. So anyway, this is what it says, that you can reduce your dimensional requirements in exchange for provision of affordable housing, reduction in the minimum lot size or the minimal lot width. So how big it is and how much frontage it has on the road can happen. But all other aspects need to conform to the ordinance. So the question is, what's the impact of reduced dimensions? Do these reductions apply to both affordable and market rate lots? So the answer is that, and I'll show you in a minute, lot sizes shrink dramatically as the number of units and the site program gets larger. You see what I mean in a minute, and you've actually seen some of these diagrams I think I gave you guys a couple months ago. So when asked for clarification, our village planner, when we met with him this June, we asked this question about, do these reductions apply to the affordable and market rate? And he thought that they applied only to the affordable, but he wasn't sure.
And the corollary there was to follow up with you, which we have still yet to do. So that wasn't an answer, just so you know.
Okay, but it was, you know, the lack of, it's more my point is not to, you know, to criticize. It's just to basically say that the uncertainty and imprecision in zoning, obviously, it makes you vulnerable, right?
Correct.
Because obviously, it can open to interpretation. So just to show you some of the lot size reductions. And there's, again, we've already talked about how there are no unit number, caps in the whole R1 district. So if you keep putting a bigger building on in the whole district. So just to show you what happens as lots get...
Well, let me interrupt you for a moment. Yeah. I just wanted to say that it does seem astute for if someone doesn't know the answer that they would then do the research and get back to you.
Yes, but also the code would be very explicit, and I'll get to the reason in a second.
I guess I was referring just to the comment about saying you didn't know something. It's fair to say that someone who does research doesn't get back to you.
Oh, absolutely.
And to end this point, I fully agree about ambiguity.
No, absolutely. And that's the point, too. I think Rachel is bringing up a really good point. So basically, the code isn't fail-safe. And we're human beings, and also people are hired to enforce the code. That's why we have a zoning enforcement officer. And that's why we have a BZA, a Board of Zoning Appeals. So we have these systems in place. And they're like gates, right? So the first thing is you look at the ordinance, then when you want clarification, you talk to the zoning enforcement officer. If you need a variance because you don't fit the guidelines, you have to go before the BZA. You can also go before the BZA if you don't really agree with how the zoning enforcement officer interpreted the zoning. So the zoning enforcement officer is not, you know, fail-safe either. Zoning enforcement officer, when they're dealing with codes that has ambiguities in it too, they may make a determination based on experience or precedent. Somebody might find a hole in it or disagree with it, then they can proceed to the BZA. So yes, we have a structure in place. It is definitely not, you know, it's precise to the extent that it's not to be, right? We're new. But anyway, my point was mostly just to show that there's these ambiguities. So anyway, just to return to the affordable size reductions, you know, basically, if you have 20% affordable in your development property, you can have an 80% reduction in the site size, like lot size and frontage. So if you have a 100-foot lot, you can go down to 80 feet, and you can reduce the size also by 80%. You can go down to 12,000 square feet. The higher the affordability, you can get bigger reductions, but you can't exceed a 35%, a 65% reduction. So you have to have, you have 35% or more affordable units in your development, you can take a 65% reduction in lot size. So this is just to show you, so if you have a single family home, it's 15,000 square feet, with an 80% reduction, it goes down to 12,000. With 65, it goes down to 97.5. For one family home, that doesn't sound so bad.
I think just to clarify, it's actually a 35% reduction.
Yes.
Not a 65. It is one is 265%.
Yes.
Not 80 and 65. Reduction.
Right.
People are getting confused.
Okay. But anyway, just so you see, this is a lot. This is the setback, the little darker gray, and the black is just like a building, you know, just to show you how it relates to the scale of the lot. So you can just see also a single family home, the lot can get skinnier and smaller, and you can put a house on it. But you can see also you can get skinnier and skinnier and skinnier. You can't get any skinnier in our current zoning than 9,072. You get a two family, and this is the important thing, every time the lots get smaller, the program for the site is the same, right? You need the same amount of cars, you got the same amount of people, you just got a smaller lot area. So if you have a two-family home, you can see how it shrinks too. It doesn't make as big a difference with these smaller homes. Three-family home starts to shrink also. It's when you start to get bigger. Here's four family and five family. Now for four family, we've got smaller lot, but we have also got 8 cars on it. For five family, we've got 10 cars. And then we go up and up and up, so we get to 40 lot, a 40 unit property. And it's gone down considerably to this size, and it still has 80 cars on it. And look how much less land area it has around it. So these lot reductions are very significant, especially as the size of the program for the site gets bigger. It has a huge impact on, you know, the development, especially in a village where a village situation here, where you aren't urbanized, you don't want to rely on having a lot of gray infrastructure. You want more permeable surfaces, you want more green because it uptakes water. And also, rural character is about green foregrounding the landscape. Everything is green. We want a landscape foregrounding. So it's also about sort of quality of life. But this is an important thing to really look at, I think, in this zoning. And I don't question the idea of having benefits. I think the scales have to be really looked at carefully. And, you know, that there are some caps on those scales, those levels. So this question came up about this reduction. Do they apply to both market rate and affordable? And I mentioned again, and Rachel asked, well, it makes sense to ask. But he couldn't determine the answer. The zoning enforcement officer wasn't sure. But the developers are certain that it applies to both. And that has come up just recently in their proposal. They argue that they have 15 lots. And if they put the maximum affordable bonus on them, they can get 84 units on that property. And they apply the affordable bonus to every lot, regardless of whether it was a market rate or an affordable lot. So they believe that the affordable reduction extends to both the market rate homes as well as the affordable homes. And that's a pretty significant thing, because that number then looks really big compared to that number, which the developers are saying they're going to do. That looks like a pretty generous environment compared to that. I mean, 184 units. Whoa! But that is in this chart that was just provided in the December submission, and also the narrative that goes with it. It is argued that affordability in our code can plot the affordable reduction of applies to all lots. Well, so we have planned development areas. Planned development areas allow development to enable and encourage flexibility design. This is a nice thing that was added to the zoning ordinance in 2012. However, there is no map, no indication in the zoning map of where planned development areas would occur. So if you wanted to ask where are the PDA sites in the village, and what would development on land parcels look like if this were applied, there are no designated PDA zones. It would only be the discretion of the developer. The density is based on, this is an important thing to know though, that the density of planned development areas is based on lot count for conventional homes, but it requires clustering, so it's mandatory. It has design flexibility, and it requires 20% minimum open space, and it does not include stormwater, cannot be calculated in that area. So anyway, I did a little map on the 46 South Street parcel to show what a planned development scenario would enable, just so you get some sense of contrast in the type of ways that the different codes, the different strategies can impact a particular site. And this is one of the disconnects for many people with the 46 South Street parcel is a lot of what they see doesn't look necessarily like what they're familiar with. Not that it has to look just like what they're familiar with, but maybe there could be a little bit more balanced structure. But anyway, this is applying a 50% affordable single family home to the South Street parcel, 46 South Street. We come up with 21 affordable homes and 14 market rate for a total of 35. Just to give you a sense of what number of single family homes with a large portion of affordable homes. These become the smaller lots down to 7,500 square feet, something like that. Here's what a planned development area cluster scenario could look like on that particular site. where you took those 35 homes, that was the lot count, now you're allowed to squeeze them into a smaller area, preserve open space, limit the amount of infrastructure that's built like roads, and you could end up with maybe a third of the site being public open space and devoted to stormwater. So those are, it's really important to see these different kind of scenarios. But my concern with the zoning ordinance is there is no place on the village map, village zoning map, that has designated the appropriate places for planned development. And whether planned development needs to be reconsidered so that some of the densities increase, that could happen too. But it's distressing, to say the least. Anyway, just to kind of start to close up here, other obstacles to effective land use planning and decision making. There are incomplete priorities of the comp plan. We don't have a preferred usage for developable undeveloped land. There was never a plan done for that, but it's a comp plan priority. We haven't set aside sites for green space and networks and walking trails. There's no plan for that. And we have not identified, in the village where high density housing could be established and by adding additional streets. There has not been any determination of where that should happen. This creates disadvantages because we have to do short-term, we're making short-term decisions, and they prevail over long-term planning. We could be vulnerable to unwanted development, that vulnerability rises. We have zoning and planning boards that are unable to conduct reviews and make decisions effectively due to lack of planning tools. If you don't have some of these things in place, how do you make those decisions? We have a planning board that maybe not apt to prioritize such things as open space and recreation without long-term plans on which to rely. So just to kind of closing up here to show you a little example of the Cazenovia comparison. And the reason I actually picked Cazenovia is because it keeps getting cited in things like your housing studies. It's all over the place. I'm like, oh, I'm going to look at Cazenovia. I'm going to really look at it and see what Cazenovia has been doing with zoning. So, and it's kind of a good and apt comparison because the scales of these two villages are quite similar. Cazenovia and Germansburg. You know, we have 1.6 square miles in Cazenovia. We have 1.2 in Germansburg. Population's a little higher in Cazenovia than in Germansburg. But you have similar, you can even see looking at the texture of it, it has a similar context. We have a concentrated center and we have periphery that is more, the lake on the one hand. We have more agriculture around us. But it's very telling to look at the two maps. It's like the first thing you see, you start to squint your eyes, it's like, wow, looks like Peter Max. This is Jason. For those of you who know Peter Max, it's very colorful. Cazenovia is very colorful. Germansburg is kind of banal. You know, one square mile of one color. Some of the differences. Germansburg has one single R1 zone. It has no multi-family zone. It has no plan development zone. It has limitless principal buildings in R1. It has limitless building types and sizes. Cazenovia has four R districts. It has a multifamily zone. It has a planned development zone. It has clear limits on principal buildings, building types, and coverages. But the big thing is to see the sort of texture and character, because if the zoning responds to the extent complexity of the community and it anticipates building that kind of complex mosaic of land development over time. So what happens out here, and what happens there, and what happens there is not all the same. It responds to different conditions, whether it's by the lake, it's in a historical area. Okay, so just to show you a little breakdown of the six residential zones in Cazenovia, your good reference point. Basically, R30 is the largest, tends to happen on the edges, whereas it's from the historic core, borders agriculture and the lake. It's a 30,000 square foot minimum. Very succinct, one family, residential access structures, home occupation limited. specific requirements in terms of lot coverage, width minimums, and road frontage. I'm going to get down to R20, 20,000. All of these four, by the way, specify that you can only have one principal building per lot. One principal building per lot in a residential area. However, you can get all the way down to a 6,000 square foot lot. So you have around areas around the historic core, you get smaller lots. So you can build smaller homes, smaller lots. But you also, as you get smaller, you know, and larger, the maximum lot coverage change as well. Then we have an RM district, which is the residential multifamily. There's a max. One family, two family, or a maximum of 10 in the multifamily zone. We don't have a max. We could have 100. We could have 200. We could have 500. We don't have a max. So they have a max. Then we have also planned development areas that are places that encourage alternative concepts of clustering and mixed use. So those have to be at least 5 acres in size, there's greater choice in building types, and basically those are the kind of things that I showed you a little bit earlier in terms of the planned development areas. Scott, do you want to talk a little bit about the housing?
I'll just stand here because basically there's a single slide on this. TBNA, in thinking about all the things that Paul has spoken about so far, started to kind of dig deeper and say, okay, there is a housing study which has been done back in 2015, and the village has referred to it in some ways, gradually, I believe, informally, as being a mini comp plan specific to housing. So I would applaud the village for looking ahead and saying, okay, there are some updates that are going to be required here, which is really, you can see the thrust of this whole presentation is where are the updates, what needs to be done in terms of the different laws that actually are adequately and appropriately protective of development. So in any event, actually it's Nancy Tubbs, who's not here this evening, so I'm taking the place for the moment. Has done a very in-depth study, or very in-depth review of what is in that 2005 housing study. And TBNA plans within the next coming weeks to be able to pulling together a pretty significant review of that study in terms of what it points out and some of the things that it's found in terms of some of the inadequacies in that study, some of the contradictions, some of the inadequate kind of mining of the data, the process, etc. But there's just a few things to really jump out together, you know, as we look at this housing study, which were indicators in the study which appear not, at least to our review, not to be accurate relative if you actually just look at the data in the study in terms of the findings that are presented. That's apart from the fact that the study has various different challenges, let me say, in terms of methodology, the number of people, how the people were selected, etc. So, the extent that it can actually be used as being appropriately representative of an opinion in a village such as ours comes into question. Anyway, the main things that pop out that are just going to profile here tonight in advance of us having a larger review study that we can present is that there actually is no mandate for additional housing in that data. If you really look at it, residents are equally split as to whether they desire additional development. Single-family and senior housing are the most preferred. They jump out pretty significantly. And the only housing style found really undesirable by most residents, and this would be the majority in terms of how they respond to the data, is apartments with 5 or more complex units. Okay. Residents find low density very attractive, and there's no preference for medium density housing. Okay. The report actually says there's a preference for medium density housing. Presumably, findings, analysis from the data. We would differ from that, and that's the kind of thing we'll point out in more detail. So, the biggest reason, because one of the things that people talked about was having to leave town and fear about high taxes. Well, let me go at it differently. So, people, one of the concerns about and needs, which I totally would accept and believe, for having housing that is affordable housing that, you know, is available to a larger cross-section of potential residents, there is a need for that. So, but in this data, if you really look at it, the biggest reason people mention for why they will leave the village is high taxes, suggesting that any village project should really aim to lower taxes. Right? So then that pulls into question, and again, I would appreciate a mob board, really, because I know that there's consideration right now about having a consultant think about the economic impacts of the current proposal before you. So it would go to, does it really lower taxes or not? If it will be consistent with what is being expressed in this housing study. Okay, so I'm not going to go further with that at this point. As I mentioned, we are going to have be preparing, we've got all the data analysis down, it's just a matter of putting it into a report. So we'll, that'll be worth that. Okay, do you have any questions?
Yeah, and Nancy also said that she would have to do a presentation via Zoom
right.
Later. Anyway, I just have a couple more slides. So with its inconsistent provisions, unclear or vague provisions, or in some cases no provisions at all, Shimmonsburg zoning ordinance is jeopardizing the village. This is our opinion from this analysis that we've done. And many of us have been looking at this zoning since May. So we've been looking at it for a long time. So, and this is, I think, the key thing for the village board to really think about and ponder, is that in the absence of legislative clarification, any inconsistencies or unclear provisions must be interpreted in favor of the property owner, developer, as a matter of law. So the property owner and the developer is privileged when the zoning ordinance is unclear, because they are favored as a matter of law. So, this is why people are upset, because there is a sense of lack of power and empowerment in the face of major development and change. Because you do know that when your planning tools and your laws have inconsistencies and lack of clarity in them, those who have the interests of development are actually going to be privileged in favor. So this is a very serious issue, and I think this is why people are upset. Is it true? But anyway, some of the things that we see as priority recommended actions would be to have a moratorium on all new and pending major subdivisions, at which time that would give time to amend, update, or redraft pertinent development-related laws. And as Marty said to us, like, oh, Paul, we're going to do all these laws. I mean, there are a lot of laws. There is a need for these to come into synchronicity with one another, because we have things like subdivision and done in 2008, and then we have zoning done in 2012. So there is this need, and I know how demanding that is for a village government that has limited resources. And this is, you know, one of the things that has made us vulnerable, and all of us who have done large projects here in the village, like making that Main Street project happen, we know what level of volunteerism and dedication it took from citizens as well as from the government. But that need to get the integration of these current goals related to affordable housing, multi-unit housing, cluster zoning, land preservation, green infrastructure, you get all these things to really be integrated. And then to amend and update the comprehensive plan by undertaking the priority actions that I mentioned that haven't happened, as well as that have immediate impact on land use and development planning. And I don't have an including, that was from, this is taken from the document. But then also, as we, who are part of TVNA, and many of us who've been here for a long time, are really dedicated to transparent community processes, when revisions like these take place. And I know one of the things that has been a little bit disrupting or disturbing, distressing, for many of us who have been in the midst of all this discussion over the last few months, is that there has been a committee that's been at work on zoning here in the village, and that has not been open to the public. There have not been public meetings that we could attend. We do not have any input on that. We don't know what people are doing. My personal opinion, some of the things that I've heard seem like the land is being treated more as a commodity economically. How many lots can you fit on a site, as opposed to how can you develop the land to get the best of its economic, social, and environmental qualities to interact with one another in a way that really produces a wonderful and attractive village. So I think that is a real big concern of ours, is how can we do things that move forward in ways that really fully engage the community in these very important decisions.
Can you go back to the Catherine Ollier slide?
Yeah.
And the zoning on that.
Which slide?
The picture.
Peter Max had a zoning.
So actually, wasn't there one that compared for Castanovia? I just Googled it. It's like, it's 51 square miles. That's
Castanovia. You may have the town.
Okay. That's what I was trying to
understand. No, it's exactly the same size. In fact, I scaled those maps.
I needed that clarity.
Okay, that's all right.
There goes back.
There's the two. These are the details, Debbie, just in terms of size. 1.2 square miles. I mean, I don't have the boundaries on.
Right, that's okay.
And so it's more to show the context of the scale. 1.2 square, 1.6. Land is 1.2 square.
Yeah.
Okay. Elevation is a little different. Population. You know, isn't that different? The density is a little higher in Casanova. So, and that was, you know, I think earlier, you can see these are the larger, R30 is larger 30,000 square foot lots, and you can see they're on land that's much less developed. These are planned development areas, and you can kind of see the density, so those require open space and clustering of houses. We have multifamily. Here's multifamily, or the big bright yellow ones, a couple of those. And you have these different things, depending on where you are in the context of the community, whether you're near the college or downtown, you know, residential 10,000 square foot, 20,000 square foot lots, 6,000 square foot lots. So you have a lot of variation. On that, I know it's been one of the discussions, you know, is how do we get some, because we do have the advantages of storing water, how can we get infill in the existing village, which makes total sense, by some lot size reduction. And where should they all be the same? You know, I would certainly question whether you would want to have very small lots at the end of South Street. And I think, you know, the other thing is, I know that Rachel asked, you know, are you here as a town of Ulysses resident? No, I'm here as a citizen, and I am a town of Ulysses resident. But I live on a road, Pennsylvania Avenue, that extends from the town into the village. And I think that's a very important thing, of these boundaries between the two and how they are they become seamless and integrated. And if there's anybody who lives in an area that is the most desirable area for development, right outside the village, with all the benefits of the village, and also I have water, so I pay water bills. Those boundary areas are very important. So there you have to argue for really clearly working together with the town to think about that kind of smart growth that happens in a way that reinforces nodal development. I also want to fully disclose that for 30 years we have lived across from the village dump. So just to give you an indication about how things change. So I daily wake up at 7 to the equipment coming down the street from the village to do things like move around stuff. And in the middle of the night, when you guys have a water break in town, I have your equipment driving across the street for me. In fact, one day, last year, I had to call the police because I thought somebody was down there murdering somebody in the middle of the night. The lights were down, I heard shots, I thought somebody was being killed. And I called the police, and the village police came out, and they checked on it, and no, it was not a dead body. But it was them banging at 3 in the morning, the equipment, down in the village dump. So, you know, these are these kind of how we share these spaces and how we all share affection and concern for the quality of our communities. While we could say, I live in the village, I live in the town, but we
share this environment, and I think that's a really important thing to think about. I think we all share not only a great affection for us, but also a sense that we are committed to this future. And, you know, that kind of also brings up for me one of the issues that I've heard a lot of discourse about lately. It's the need for young families, which we all want young families, but it also is at the expense. There's something in it about suggesting that people who are old should leave, that it's time for you to move on. And one of the great things about Kernsburg is that people stay. And people who are elderly do not want to be displaced. It's a community that favors, I think, the kind of sense of cohesion and community belonging, where people want to stay in their houses, they want to be part of this community, they're invested in it. So people do not want to be displaced. As much as people want to come to Kernsburg, people don't want to be displaced at all. It's something to be thinking about, too, as we have a little bit of a side, but it's clearly, I think, really important to us. But I would entertain any questions, Scott, or any questions?
Can you do one?
From you guys?
Hold on.
Yeah, do you want, do you
this is village board only, please.
Yeah, no, no, I know.
I'm not open, this
I'm
is not open.
I'm in here, guys. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen.
I don't have any questions, so thank you for your time.
It's a lot of
them. I do have one question. I also, Paula, I appreciate the depth and breadth of your research and your presentation. You mentioned it very briefly once, but I'm wondering if you could give us your interpretation of the scope and authority of site plan review as written in this document.
In this document?
In the 2012 document.
Well, it's a separate. Well, it is. It is in there. So one of the concerns I have with the site plan review is it is very unclear about architecture. So it doesn't actually say that you can actually evaluate architecture. And I think that would be a very important thing that we need to amend or add into the process. So, I mean, site plan review is going to, you know, you can follow on, either follow on subdivision or be part of subdivision. So you are allowed to have that integrated review. But, you know, according to what we have happening now, subdivision is dictating a particular land use, and then, you know, where the land is being developed, and site plan review is going to have to conform to that. So one of the examples, for example, is that in the current plans for the 46 South Street proposal, they are maintaining, because they're trying to conform to the zoning, so they're maintaining conformance to the zoning, which means you have very deep yard setbacks, right? And then you have things like these parking lots and front yards, and you also have driveways that are terminating front doors. So you have this argument that that conforms to the zoning. So when site plan comes around and says, you know, we don't like that, we prefer something else, we prefer you move those buildings closer to the street, planning board doesn't have any power to do that, because they would basically have to require a cluster or some other kind of development to have that power. So the planning board gives up a lot of power in terms of site plan review when you're only in conformance with the zoning, which is one of the big arguments that we keep hearing, is that everything's being done by right. So they're losing the advantages, you know, in the current development. We're doing everything by right. We're following the code. Your code is undisputable. This is how we're interpreting it. This is, you know, we have the benefit of that.
And the reason I ask is, you know, I was here for the 2012 zoning division. You clearly looked at many more site plan ordinances than I have. So it was intentionally written in such a way as to broaden the power of the planning board, so as to say that if something in the opinion of the planning board was out of context or out of nature with the comp plan, that they could, you know, section A4, disapprove of the site plan. And so within, you know, legal review back at the time, it was seen as, we were even asked, do you want to give the planning board this much authority to summarily deny an otherwise zoning compliant site plan? And the answer was yes, as a check against everything else. So I guess my question would be for you, in your experience with other site plan ordinances, have you seen one as broadly authoritative as ours?
Oh, yeah.
Be shut down in court when a planning board said, obviously you have to itemize your reasons why you would deny something, but if a planning board with broad authority such as this were to say, we're denying a project for these reasons, in your experience, have you seen that not hold up simply because the planning board was considered to not wield that power?
I don't think I'm able to really answer that question, but I think we could probably find that out for you. I don't think that's really within my purview to answer that question. Good question. But I think, obviously we want the planning board to have as much power as possible. I think in helping to determine and weigh things. But I don't think that they should be constrained by, the situation where everything's being argued, but that's by right, so they feel like they have that power. But I think you do give up a lot of power at the planning board when you don't demand things like cluster is or plan development. Those are two areas in the zoning board and the ordinance that are particularly designed to give the planning board specific power in determining the future of land. And if they don't use that power, then they basically give it up. And we don't see that power has not been advanced. And then I think you saw in the report that we gave you, we have a whole list of the rights of the planning board. There are many rights of the planning board that we haven't seen exercised yet.
Okay, Rachel, Debbie.
Yeah, well, thank you for your work.
A little louder.
So before we close,
and I also thank DNA for the time and effort you put in. I would like to say, however, this is a citizens groups committee. It's not proven fact. And people in the audience and the village board should know that. This is your opinion of our interpretation of our code and zoning.
Right.
And it may not necessarily be true. It's your interpretation of that. We have professionals that also interpret that. I just want to make that clear because sometimes people hear something and that's fact, and it may not necessarily be the case.
That is true, but I do think that having done quite a bit of reading for the current proposal before you, that a lot of the code is written. The code is written.
But it's the village board needs to determine
that
really of your concerns.
And
that's our role.
You have
that's
to do that. Absolutely.
That's our role.
Yeah, and I think, there's been a lot of, discussion about what role everyone has. Obviously, that's the reason we're here, is that you do have the role of mandating what laws are enforced and how those laws are developed and designed, how they get, applied. So that is your purview. This isn't, we weren't giving this presentation to the planning board.
Thank you. So any other village board stuff? Or it sounds like you have something else to say?
Well, yes. Just in closing, following on this last exchange here and the thought about really the reason or perhaps the validity of what we presented tonight, I just want to say, and I kind of started with this, but consistent with TVNA's goals here, which is really to provide information in a way that enables introspection, investigation, kind of really looking at it as a board and as a community. And so our hope is that, others will look at this information and say, oh, is it really true? Or let's dig deeper into this. But in any event, overall the goal here has to do with enabling civil discourse, enabling informed kind of civil discourse around these issues that we present. I do want to just take one moment to kind of name what I think is beyond the elephant in the room, which is that a lot of the critique that we provide here obviously is using the examples of Hamilton Square, right? And as I explained in the very beginning, the reasons or the way that it evolved towards that had to do with looking at Hamilton Square, just, okay, what's going on here? And then really understanding at a deeper level what it is the zoning, subdivision, comp plan are saying about development and residential. So I guess to fast forward again, I think that what comes out of this, or what PBNA's assumption is what comes out of this, through this introspection, and the hope that this conversation can happen in an informed way, is that a moratorium is seen as being an appropriate response to what we see, what we believe, is this level of inconsistencies, level of actual risk to the village in terms of how the village would like to define itself as far as future development. So, but maybe the last thing I want to say is, what would the word Paula use? This is all presented with affection and concern for the village. So there could be a lot of different perceptions, a lot of different feelings that specifically come down to, do we want affordable housing or we don't? Do we want it at this scale or do we don't? Are we for it or against it? And I think what we're really trying to do is bring texture, bring some more specificity so that that conversation can happen with a level of investigation of this nature. And I guess the last thing is, we know that we're not proposing, or what we're proposing is no small deal in terms of moratorium. Because, as you pointed out, there's a lot of different laws that got to get looked at. So, PBNA has offered itself to actually assist the village to whatever extent we feel desire, need, to kind of dig to the next level on this stuff together with you.
So we're about an hour and 25 minutes into a discussion that was supposed to be 45 minutes. So I'm going to limit the amount of public comment at this point, but we do have other things that we need to do. This is not going to be our only time that we're going to talk about probably moratorium. And part of what the village board has to look at is a plan how we want to move forward. But we started at about 10 after 7, and so we're approaching an hour and a half. I would say at this point, I'd rather have, since you made a presentation and there's has to be a lot of distilling of what's been presented, I'd rather hear public comment on what's been presented more than a question. Unless there's some minor thing that needs clarification, I think that's all very important. So, we do on the back of the agenda, have the rules. It's 3 minutes, one topic, so if you talk about what was presented here, you get 1 3-minute shot. So I see a hand back there. Name and address, please.
I'm Chris Cale. I live at 3110 Du Bois Road, which is in the town of Ulysses.
And the other thing, if you're here representing a group.
I am not representing a group, however, I have been asked by numerous members of a group, the Greater Trumansburg Adapting for the Future group, because I'm a trained professional planner, to request that the hour and 45 minutes that was made available to this group to consider the zoning ordinance that you have. I'm under some constraints, Paula's not, because I am a planner by trade. We do have a code of ethics. I can do the same sort of persuasive analysis, kind of information, kind of persuasion. But I would like to have an equal opportunity to present what I think of the ordinance. There is another planner on my road as well in Truang. The community has people who do this professionally, and would really appreciate that. I also have some comments that I can give you that I made to the planning board. I think one thing that's really important to realize is over the period of time that you had this big, long moratorium enforced because of your water supply, I noticed there was no concern. So it's hard to see why there would be such a sense of emergency, particularly given that now there actually has been some great movement in terms of hiring a planner, beginning to have some professional planning review going on, having some efforts being made to put together a committee to start reviewing and seeing what updates are necessary. A lot of what I saw today, I frankly think is inaccurate. And if you could spare the time, certainly before thinking of doing something as drastic as a zoning moratorium, I think that would be important. I also have a couple of questions about TBNA. Their Facebook page says they're recruiting political candidates to get in touch with Nancy Tubbs. That's inconsistent from my understanding of what an incorporated not-for-profit does. And I also note that they're not registered with the Charities Board of New York State.
Yes, they are. Yes, we are. We're just calling 998. Yes, we are. I have the paperwork if you'd like to see it.
Well, I haven't been able to look it up online.
And I'll give you my number. May I ask if you can give me a call? I'll give you my business card. I'll give you all that information.
Okay.
Just clarification. Fine.
Great.
So you're down to 4 seconds.
So I'm just interested in the political aspect of this and whether they're supporting political candidates.
I think the board appreciates that other, other individuals or groups with expertise could also provide assistance. Okay, others that would like to make comments? Public comment. Yes, name and address, please, and if you're representing an organization.
I'm speaking as an individual. My name is Sarah Adams from Fort Falls Street. Just to answer the question about why this, I think this is explained, but with the moratorium, obviously there was no development proposed because there couldn't be. That was what the moratorium was about. And it's really only since the water moratorium has been lifted that development is now possible. And with that development has come the realization and understanding of our zoning ordinance and what some of the deficiencies of it are. Thank you.
Yes.
William Connor, 40 South Street. Just to, I'm a member of the TBNA, but I'm speaking on behalf of myself. So just as some clarifications, I think in Paula's presentation there were some questions about road design. There are some things, as I read it in the village code, I reference section 472.8, which says that in general roads shall be 500 feet apart between intersections, which I don't believe this current plan achieves. The code also says in section 490 that a collector street, which South Street is defined as and confirmed by the developer's plan, traffic engineer, that it needs to be 40 feet minimum in width. South Street is about 20 feet, so regardless of where it comes out on South Street, it simply is not meeting the village Article 4 warning as it's written. So I'm not, I don't think I'm interpreting that. And I'll just say one last thing on affordability. For those of us who have invested 20 years or more living in this community, we can't afford for our property values to be decreased as well. So it's important to us to, we've invested a lot of time in keeping our houses nice, and keeping the community beautiful, that we want to make sure our investment is protected as well. So thank you. And thank you for hearing the group. I really appreciate that.
Thank you. Others who would like to make comments? Yes, Todd.
Yeah, hi. I'm Todd Parlato. I live on 15 Bradley Street. I want to thank the village board for their service and thank the folks who are here to present tonight, Paul and Scott, for your time and all the effort put in. It seems to me that what the board would be considering in weighing whether or not to enact a moratorium in this issue would be whether or not you're dealing with a vocal minority or a majority of the village represents that village residents that pay taxes that you represent. We have a village election that is about to happen in 2 months' time. I think it would be incredibly irresponsible for this board, particularly when a majority of this board's positions are up for re-election, to consider anything as drastic as a moratorium on the way out the door prior to an election. The election itself will have all of the stakeholders in the community that pay taxes in the village represented. That's what the election is. Thank you for hearing me out.
Any other comments or questions? Yes.
I'd like to speak.
Do Name and address, please.
Bonnie DeSombre, 251 Pennsylvania Avenue. This is a letter that I wrote after the last meeting. I appreciate the time. I appreciate the questions. I do believe you should be heard. At one of the meetings, I was upset because we only heard one side. We didn't hear those that wanted it so badly. And I'll get some of these around. I really just want to read this. This is the third letter that I've written. Thanks. So after the meeting, they said, put your thoughts. It was a relief to hear all these questions. And I'm just going to skip down to, I have a concern if we'd ever be sued. People have already had fallen or their sales haven't gone through. Would they ever sue us? I pay village taxes. Not everybody in Truensburg pays village taxes. Home sales are already affected, and if people don't buy homes here, the population will decrease, and there won't be enough people to support this village and the schools. We already have something like this up near the dollar store in Juniper Manor. We also have Ovel. Student enrollment is down everywhere, and also because our taxes are too high, our school taxes. It seems like IHNS and the property owner have had all this planned out from very long ago, and they're determined to put people here regardless of the wetlands, limited bus service, and jobs. And they keep tweaking the project so that the village will say yes. Just imagine how many complications you're going to have. I worked for a realtor up in New Hampshire, so she might come in and say, oh, we want to do a different facade, we want to do this, we want to do this to the road. They're already going, private road, regular road. And the other thing I want to tell you, on 251, we've had to do drainage. Be very careful if you do this in the sewer, because the water came in the back and the developer, instead of putting it straight back, bent it several times. So those of us in the development have different, you know, are you going to make them do a French ditch like I have, an open ditch that's more trouble? And that's going to be hard on our workers. Decisions should not be determined by those who work so hard to afford to live in the village and keep their properties nice and pay those extra taxes. And it shouldn't be determined on others saying we don't care and we're leaving them out in the cold, which is not true. We do care. But why does this huge project have to be in the last open land in the middle of a quiet village? Why can't it be a little further out so that those who want it so badly will also be paying the additional costs to keep it here? Please consider the quiet character of this special village. It's what's drawn people to come here. What will be best for the village in the years ahead? Maybe saying no will motivate the property owner to put a nice development with large and small homes on that land. And maybe INHS will find more suitable space for those who deserve better. There's still land in Truman's Firth and the town of Ulysses. Thank you.
Other comments? Tom Weiss?
Yes.
Tom Pepe,
Pennsylvania Avenue. I'd like to thank Scott and Paul for the amazing work and everybody else in TVA that has done so much work to try and see this process through. So, thank you.
Other comments? Other comments? If it's on CBNA's presentation, no.
No. It's a question for the village board. So I'm just wondering, Sarah Adams, Fort Wall Street. I'm just wondering, kind of, and obviously you've got to absorb all this information and decide you want to do with it, but at what point do you think you might be able to kind of let TBNA know kind of what your next step is going to be in reviewing all of this? I mean, is there a way to have sort of a roadmap going forward here?
That's really for the village board to determine.
Right.
How do we just got this so, presented to us? We certainly haven't formulated a plan to move forward. When we do, we'll inform you of what we're planning to do. We have suggested not to do anything until the election's up. Is one option.
So it might be on the next village board agenda for discussion, or?
It may be. I mean, I said the village board has to figure out what our next steps are.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Jack Katz, 13 South Street. And throughout this whole process, there's been a lot of talk about diversity and how a project like this would bring diversity to the community, which is in some eyes lacking. But as far as I can tell, the only diversity that can be put upon the people that will live there is economic diversity. Certain bands of economic qualifications, but no qualifications for race, age, ethnicity, sexual orientation, gender. So really, it's just the only diversity that's guaranteed is economic diversity.
Yeah, Ann Corbett, I'm a county legislator for folks, most of the folks here, but I'm speaking today as a resident of the town of Ulysses, but I've also lived, been here since 84, lived on Camp Street, Wood Street, Main Street, and when I was three, my father passed away, and my mother was left to sit along with three little kids in downtown Albany, and so without a job, a good job, and without family support, we were sent to live in what they called back then projects, the low-income Section 8 projects, which instead of being in downtown Albany where we could walk to everything, we didn't have a car, we got sent to the projects by the highway overpass. And it was devastating for my mother, for us kids, and she had a hard time trying to bounce back and recover after that. And that's not where people should go. People should stay where there's services. We have doctors, dentists, we have optometrists, grocery stores, restaurants. We have, you know, different age groups here. I lost who I thought actually was an aunt who lived upstairs, but she was just a neighbor. But I thought of her as an aunt because as little kids we used to go up there all the time. She used to watch us. And so I want people to really think about that. If you don't want them in people like that, people like me, people like my family, then we're being discriminatory. Just think about
audience,
it.
Audience, please.
So for Trumansburg Country Estates, which people refer to out just past Main Street or in the back of Main Street, I had a house there in the early 90s, and they proposed that development back there, and a lot of people were against it. But we worked with the developers for siting, for more handicapped accessibility to the apartments, and a bunch of different things. Lighting, a row of trees they put up between our properties. So that was literally my backyard, which I used to go skiing and hiking, but that wasn't my property. So they built that, and I was worried, okay, am I going to be able to sell my property? Am I going to be able to, you know, are there people going to be crossing in front of my, you know, through my yard, and all these things I had fears for. And none of those things happened. I almost doubled my property value when I sold it. I actually couldn't afford that house now with my income. And I have talked to all the people that live right adjacent to that. So that project, so that's not even affordable or mixed. This is low income housing right there, 36 units. And I talked to all the neighbors, and nobody has a problem there. A lot of them, if the houses have overturned, they don't even know what's back there. It's just, there's something back there.
36 units?
36 units. It's not the same, but 36 units.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, no.
What questions? Yeah, we have a friend. We have someone that actually speaks.
I'll be glad to talk to people afterwards or another time about my experience through there. So we have fears too.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'd rather.
Okay, I just
got
a quick thing. Canal Toronto, 1/4 Center. You know, I've lived in very mixed communities and we didn't have concern about our neighbors. Everybody kind of got along. That's the one thing I'm seeing about this whole project. It's like a village within a village that's making the village split apart. And you have one group for, one group against, very few people coming to any sort of compromise. But I don't think I see in any new people coming in, I don't know who's going to come in, and I don't care what their background is, as long as they become part of the community. And that's what I'd really like to see. Whatever happens, that this is, I don't know, this isn't making sense. But I don't care whether they are low income or higher income, as long as they're part of the community. I'd like to see first-time homeowners, truthfully. I would like to see that. But, you know, I just, I've lived in mixed groups. This community is a wonderful place to live, and people do get along. And it doesn't matter who you are or what you are, where you live, you can get along if you choose to. I think if that makes sense. I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
Don't apologize. Thank you very much.
Other than Paul, other questions or comments? Well, nothing's wrong with Paul, I think. She had an hour and 25 minutes to talk, so there's nothing wrong. If it's about what TBNA did, then no, I would say no,
just,
but okay.
It's
what
just
else
a quick thing, Jack Katz again. And it's about being discriminatory. If you took the word affordable out of this development entirely and just said, I'm going to put 77 units of housing in that lot. Think of it in that term, just not affordable, you know, diversity, not diversity, just that number of units in that space. Would that be a different consideration?
One else, because we're going to give Paul 3 minutes and then to the public comment.
I'm just going to say one word.
Well, not unless you already spoke, so you already had your time. So
I would really like to move into executive session. We already have another presentation.
All right. So what I would suggest to the village board is that one, we seek input from the planning board, the ZBA, on the potential for a moratorium from our zoning officer, from our zoning officer. So that's what I would recommend to our village board, to see other input. And one of the strong legal points about a moratorium is there has to be an imminent threat to the health, safety, and welfare of the village. You may say that because of a project that's sitting there right now. However, there are no other projects sitting out there that we're aware of. We're usually aware of projects 3 months to years ahead before they come before the public. That's been the rule of thumb in this village, including a business owner that came to us probably a year and a half before it came to fruition. We don't know of any impending projects coming. There's a current one under review at this point, but there are no other pending ones. And that's one of the thresholds that the courts tend to look at very closely. And that's what the village board's going to have to determine. Is there an imminent threat there that then should give us the ability to put a moratorium in a very defined, narrow timeline? Again, because that's the reason you get a challenge too. It's not an open-ended moratorium. So that's the last word that we're going to have for my in a few days today. So I would definitely entertain a motion of executive session. That's one possible.